السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين وعد الله الذين آمنوا منكم وعملوا الصالحات ليستخلفنهم في الأرض كما استخلف الذين من قبلهم ولا يمكنن لهم دينهم الذي ارتضى لهم ولا يبدلنهم من بعد خوفهم أمنا يعبدونني لا يشركون بي شيئا ومن كفر بعد ذلك فأولئك هم الفاسقون.
After reciting the Tashahhud, Ta'awuz, Tasmiyah and Surah Fatiha, Hazrat Amir al-Mu'mineen Ayyadullah Ta'ala ibn Silazi recited verse number 56 of Surah Al-Nur and then said, "The translation of this verse is as follows. Allah has promised to those among you who believe and do good works that He will surely make them successors in the earth as He made successors from among those who were before them, and that He will surely establish for them their religion which He has chosen for them, and that He will surely give them in exchange security and peace after their fear. They will worship Me, and they will not associate anything with Me. Then whoso is ungrateful after that, they will be the rebellious." This verse, as it is evident from the subject matter, declares the promise of Allah the Almighty to Muslims that Khilafat, i.e. Caliphate, will continue to remain in Islam. However, according to a saying of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, due to the conduct of the Muslims and the state of their faith, this blessing was to be temporarily seized from them. Nevertheless, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also added that in accordance with the promise of Allah the Almighty, this system was to be re-established and reinstated in the world for those who are firm on their faith, do good deeds and follow this final and complete religion.
مسلمان علماء کے غلط نظریات قرآن کریم اور آن حضرت صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کی تعلیم اور ارشادات کی گہرائی کو نہ سمجھنے
As a result of the erroneous views of the Muslim clerics, and owing to a lack of deep understanding of the Holy Quran and of the teachings and sayings of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but also their superficial interpretations and commentaries, the majority of the Muslims do not understand how the system of Khilafat was to be established. There is also a large section of the Muslims who say that there is no need for any Khilafat. Everyone should just follow the sect that they are part of, and that is sufficient. The state of Muslims of today's age, and the way Islam is being defamed, demands that everyone continues to follow his chosen path. One imam of a local mosque living in one of the Western countries, who also runs an institute and is a religious cleric who on the face of it has a good understanding of religious knowledge. Furthermore, he has good relations with us Ahmadis and does not deem Ahmadis to be unpleasant, told me that the elders of the denomination that I belong to have said that do not disturb anyone else's religion, nor give up your own religion. Thus, those who hold such views and are called religious scholars will instruct their adherents and followers that there is no need to unite as one. These things demonstrate that according to them, their personal interests and divisions amongst Muslims are more important than the greater good of the Muslim Ummah and their uniting under one hand. Thus, when one does not understand the teachings of the Holy Quran and does not ponder over the sayings of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then this is the outcome. Whilst mentioning the lack of knowledge of the Muslims, or rather the lack of understanding and ignorance of the Muslim scholars, the Promised Messiah alayhi salam stated, some people deny the general connotation of the verse, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كَمَا اسْتَخْلَفَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ, i.e. the broader meaning of this verse, by saying that minkum, i.e. from among you, can only refer to the companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the rightly guided caliphate terminated with them. The Promised Messiah alayhi salam then states, they say that the rightly guided caliphate terminated with the companions, and according to them, until the Day of Judgment, there will be no system of caliphate in Islam. This is to say that Khilafat was like a mere dreamlike state, only to last for 30 years. From then on, Islam was to suffer an ominous decline, heaven forbid. The Promised Messiah alayhi salam further states, I ask the question, can any virtuous individual entertain the belief that the dispensation and caliphate of Prophet Moses, peace be upon him, lasted for 1400 years? Yet, that individual, who is the best of all the messengers, and the best among all the prophets, the blessings of whose dispensation was to last until the Day of Judgment. His blessings were to last only until his era, as if to say that God Almighty did not wish for the blessings of his model to be exhibited through his spiritual caliphs. Listening to such statements sends shudders throughout my body. It is truly regretful that people who call themselves Muslims use such vile and unbridled language with the utmost guile that it seems as though the blessings of Islam were extinguished long ago rather than awaiting for the blessings in the future. At another place, the promised Messiah alayhi salam also stated, "If the caliphate was only to last for 30 years, after which there was to be nothing, and also the golden era of Islam was confined to this, then God Almighty had the power to grant the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam 30 more years until the age of 97, which is not an unusual age. Then what was the need of the caliphate?" Thus, there are people who are of this opinion as well, about whom the Holy Prophet ﷺ mentioned with detail. However, there are some individuals who wish to establish the caliphate using the support of worldly powers. They think that the caliphate can be established using their might. These people have failed to understand the clear message of God Almighty, that this promise is stipulated with faith and virtuous deeds. Becoming a true servant of God Almighty is a condition attached to this promise. Owing to this misconception held by ordinary Muslims, has enabled the forces working against Islam to establish organizations that play a role in weakening the Islamic world. They aided those people who aligned themselves behind the system of caliphate. However, after a short period of time, they achieved some worldly success. Yet, when they stopped receiving support from their worldly benefactors, and also owing to the fact that they achieved their worldly pursuits, this system terminated. Three years ago, a journalist in Ireland asked me, "What is the truth behind the system of caliphate that has appeared in the Islamic world? What dangers are posed to your caliphate by this?" I explained to him that this is not a caliphate. They are a group of extremists, and their end will be the same as the rest of the extremist organizations. As long as their worldly benefactors are happy with them, they will work for them. However, the minute they stop providing them with support, they will slowly become weaker. How can these people provide any support to the faith? And how can they expect to establish peace? Indeed, the world has witnessed how they have destroyed the peace of the Islamic world. The forces working against Islam have set an agenda for which they have fulfilled, and the leaders of Muslim countries are also involved in this, who have shed the blood of their citizens just to save their seats. Even up until now, Muslims are fearful of other Muslims. Alongside this, they are disrupting the peace of the rest of the world.
لیکن ایک درد مند مسلمان جب یہ دیکھتا ہے
Whatever the reasons may be, when a kind-hearted Muslim sees that innocent people are being killed and devastation is being caused by Muslims, it creates unease in their mind and are perturbed by it. Recently, here in the United Kingdom, an incident took place in Manchester, where 22 or 23 people were needlessly killed, including innocent children. This was an outrageous act of cruelty and can never be associated with the teachings of Islam at any cost. We are perturbed by these atrocious acts of terror. May Allah have mercy on the deceased and grant steadfastness to their relatives. May Allah stop the hands of these tyrants who are carrying out vicious acts in the name of Islam and the Caliphate. Similarly, the atrocities, killing and barbaric acts being committed in Muslim countries are all a result of moving away from religion and disobeying the commandments of Allah the Almighty. The pain of all these acts that are contrary to the teachings of Islam and the atrocities that are being carried out in its name, as well as the manner in which Muslim governments, with the help of non-Muslim governments, are causing unwarranted bloodshed, can be felt the most by us Ahmadis. Since we have recognized the true teachings of Islam and its teachings of love and peace, as well as that caliphate for which we have witnessed the signs of turning times of fear into peace. We can empathize the most in this regard. In this day and age, we are the ones who have understood the teachings of the Quran and can comprehend the directives issued by the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because we have recognized the teachings of peace and harmony in Islam through accepting the Khatam al-Khulafa, i.e. the seal of the Caliphs, i.e. the promised Messiah alayhi salam. Caliphate is not something that can be established through the power of worldly forces, nor can it be established by scheming or through resolutions that are formed by so-called scholars, as was witnessed some years ago when Muslims gathered together to elect a caliph. The system of caliphate that transforms times of difficulty into peace, and the one that strengthens the faith through seeking the pleasure of God, can only be formed by the manner in which has been explained by God Almighty and His Messenger. And that can be found in Surah Jummah of the Holy Quran, where God Almighty states, وَآخَرِينَ مِنْهُمْ لَمَّا يَلْحَقُوا بِهِمْ And among others from among them who have not yet joined them. When this verse was revealed, a companion sitting in the company of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam inquired, O Messenger of Allah, who are those people who have not yet joined them, but still hold the status of being called the companions? The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not answer until the companion asked for a third time, after which the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam placed his hand on the shoulder of Hazrat Sulaiman, the Persian, and said, "When the faith reaches the Pleiades, some individuals from among these people would attain it." Regarding the status of those others who have not yet joined them, the Holy Prophet ﷺ once said, "My people are a blessed nation. It will be difficult to decipher if the first century will be the most blessed or the last century." Thus, the Holy Prophet ﷺ himself gave the glad tidings of the blessings of the latter days. Will we gain the blessings of the latter days by following these clerics and kings? Absolutely not. These people are all worldly orientated. It can only be achieved through following that individual who was to bring back the faith. Today, aside from the system established by the ardent devotee of the Holy Prophet ﷺ, who is attempting to establish the Islamic faith in this world through love and peace, and striving to establish the faith in this world? In this era of disbelief and misguidance, this responsibility lies with the community of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, and we must continue to do this. There are countless incidents that have taken place with me and with others too for that matter. Peace conferences are held, as well as Jalsa Salana takes place, in which external guests partake. When we present our message as the true message of Islam, non-Ahmadis, Christians and atheists alike say that this is the true message, and most certainly this is the Islam which needs to be spread around the world. Furthermore, if you spread this true Islam, then there will be no reason for anyone to reject it. Hence, this is the task we have at hand. In order to renew and strengthen the faith, we must hold firm to the Promised Messiah alayhi salam and Mahdi, who is the seal of the Caliphs. Regarding the latter-day people and holding fast onto them, the Promised Messiah alayhi salam states, "The crux of the verse is that God Almighty is that God who sent the Messenger in a time when the people were completely deprived of knowledge and understanding. Furthermore, the prospect of any religious wisdom through which perfection of the soul could be accomplished and mankind's knowledge and deeds to reach their pinnacle had completely vanished. To allow mankind to reach perfection and for the understanding of faith to reach its pinnacle, as well as for the development of religious knowledge and for one to improve one's wisdom and conduct, an era dawned which was the era of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was a period when all these things had completely disappeared and when the people were in complete misguidance, i.e. they strayed far away from God Almighty and His straight path. Consequently, God Almighty sent the unlettered messenger, peace be upon him, who purified them and taught them the knowledge of the book and wisdom. In other words, through clear signs and miracles, He brought them to the stage of reaching perfection in faith. He showed them clear signs and performed miracles. He displayed the signs of God's immense powers, after which they progressed in their faith to such an extent that it perfected their faith and illuminated their hearts with the cognizance of God. The promised Messiah alayhi salam further states, then the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam stated that there is a group who will appear in the latter days. They too will be in the same darkness and waywardness as the first, and they will be distant from knowledge and wisdom and true faith. Then God Almighty will mold them in the form of the Sahaba, i.e. the companions of the Holy Prophet. Whatever the companions witnessed, they too will be shown the same signs, to the extent that their loyalty and faith will reach the level of the companions. Hence, the Promised Messiah instilled true faith and conviction in his companions in a manner that they offered sacrifices in order to perfect that faith and emerge from the darkness which had spread all over the world and made the people to forsake Islam. The Promised Messiah came to rejuvenate Islam, while at the same time, these companions who attached themselves with the Promised Messiah gained that radiance which is the light of faith. They witnessed an array of signs which number in the hundreds of thousands and can be found in our literature. To this day, there are many who are emerging from the darkness to see the light, and having seen the signs, they enter into the fold of the Ahmadiyya community. The Promised Messiah alayhi salam says that his followers are those who attain certainty of belief and spiritual light through the fresh signs and support of God Almighty, in the same way the companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did. They endure adversity for the sake of God the Almighty in the form of ridicule, mockery, derision, taunts, torment, verbal abuse and cruelty. They suffer the misfortune of their relatives abandoning them, which was the same tribulation the companions of the Holy Prophet ﷺ had to suffer. The accounts of adversity are not something that we only find from the time of the Promised Messiah ﷺ, nor are they something specific to only the region his advent took place, i.e. India and Pakistan. In fact, because he, the Promised Messiah, came in servitude to the Holy Prophet to unite the whole world into one ummah and into the servants of God Almighty, thus, in other parts of the world too, the followers of the Promised Messiah have faced difficulties, hardships and adversity. However, they bear all the suffering and misfortune with extraordinary patience and steadfastness. The example of Algeria in this regard is right before us. The Jamaat there is not all that old. However, after they have accepted the Promised Messiah alayhi salam and thus joined the latter days ones and have followed the Khilafat, and so their faith is elevated to the highest levels. We can gauge the faith and firm belief of these Ahmadis who have been jailed through the following letter that was sent yesterday, or rather I received yesterday, where the writer says, countless thanks to God Almighty that He enabled us to accept the true Islam, which has reinvigorated our hearts and made us into a solid structure. Those who love one another for the sake of attaining his pleasure and who have united at the hands of the Khalifa. Addressing me, he writes, O leader, after being imprisoned in the way of Allah, Ahmadi brothers from all over the country are coming to meet me. We are joyous and exuberant upon the special grace of God the Almighty that we have received. Despite being a prisoner, the writer is jubilant for the blessings of Allah the Almighty being bestowed. He says, "They have requested me to convey their heartfelt salam and request for prayers. All are resolute that the work towards spreading the ultimate truth and prayers should continue. We will continue our mission in the face of the fiercest hardships and adversity. We will constantly seek help from Allah the Almighty and engage in prayer." Then he writes, "We witnessed your prayers being accepted with our very own eyes during this time of difficulty. We saw numerous signs which increased our faith and conviction in the true servant of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, of the promised Messiah. The mercy of God the Almighty is descending upon the weak Ahmadis of Algeria. Some Ahmadi prisoners have been set free in the last few days there. May Allah the Almighty create the means for the other Ahmadis to also be free." Another Ahmadi prisoner in Algeria writes, "During my stay in prison, I came to believe that being imprisoned was a result of a special plan of Allah the Almighty. In other words, the punishment he received and being put in jail and the court cases against them was all due to a special plan of Allah the Almighty, so that he displayed some of his special miracles. He wished to show us his signs, and this is why he placed us in these hardships. When I was out of prison in a state of comfort and ease, I thought that our successes was a reflection of witnessing God the Almighty and becoming aware of his path. However, now I have realized that we had only experienced God the Almighty to a very small degree, and now we see the real examples of the signs of his powers. I had no qualms at all about being imprisoned. What concerned me was that I had not fulfilled the rights of Allah the Almighty and of his worship. During my imprisonment, I saw many dreams which gave me tranquility." Addressing me, he writes, "I also met you in my dreams. Your prayers strengthened our faith and belief and gave us comfort in jail. Certainly our release is a result of the prayers made by you and the Jamaat." He then writes, "I request you to pray for my wife, as she has dealt with this with great patience and struggle. His wife is the only Ahmadi in her entire family, as all her other relatives are non-Ahmadi. When he was imprisoned, her father passed away, and then all her brothers left her because she accepted Ahmadiyyat. When hue and cry was raised because she was an Ahmadi, the brothers decided to abandon their sister. Her husband was already in jail during this time." He writes, "During my imprisonment, she, i.e. his wife, was distant from my relatives as well. Perhaps they were not Ahmadis either. However, pious Ahmadi women filled this gap with their love, and family was formed through them. Her close ones left her. However, the Ahmadiyya community embraced her. Men and women gave sacrifices within their spheres and continue to do so in various places. As the Promised Messiah alayhi salam has said, that they, i.e. the companions, were also inflicted with adversity and hardships. However, with the grace of Allah, this tiny Jamaat of Algeria is displaying great steadfastness during this period of tribulation. Their feelings and sentiments are reflected through just these two letters. He also wrote that he receives constant peacefulness through the ongoing system of Khilafat of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam. Whilst the opponents take steps to create fear, Allah the Almighty, through His special grace, linked to being attached to Khilafat, creates the means for tranquility. One goes through periods of difficulty both on a personal level and collectively as a Jamaat. According to His promise, Allah the Almighty constantly grants the means for peace and tranquility. This does not only occur in a specific period. As I related examples from the past, Allah the Almighty has promised those who believe and perform pious actions that He will remove their fears. At the same time, Allah the Almighty repeatedly reminds the true believers that they should fulfill the rites of His worship. When they fulfill this rite, then even in times of fear, whether on a personal or communal level, then this fear will be transformed into peace due to their attachment with Khilafat and God the Almighty and the mentality that will form within them as a result. Apart from a handful, these Ahmadis from Algeria have never even met the Khalifa. However, because they have complete faith, Allah the Almighty brings about the means for their tranquility. In the same way that at the time of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam, the means for tranquility was created for those near him. Look at the history of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat. In the first Khilafat, this very means to peace and tranquility was bestowed by the virtue of the blessings of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam and the system of Khilafat that was established. Severe adversity was faced during the second Khilafat. However, the means to peace were granted. Similarly, harsh circumstances manifested during the third Khilafat. The leader of Pakistan at the time boasted that he will ensure that Ahmadis are forced to resort to a begging bowl. However, Allah the Almighty brought about the means to ease. During the fourth Khilafat as well, Allah the Almighty created these means. Today as well, Allah the Almighty continues to create these same means. In short, these circumstances are not specific to this region. Rather, they are linked with those true believers who remain closely attached with the true Khilafat, which was established by Allah the Almighty. This is all occurring because Allah the Almighty promised the Promised Messiah alayhi salam that through the second manifestation after him, namely Khilafat, he would complete his mission and he would grant Islam triumph and victory once again and bestow tranquility about his followers. Thus, in the pamphlet, The Will, i.e. Al-Wasiyat, the Promised Messiah alayhi salam writes regarding his departing this world and the continued progress of the Jamaat through Khilafat by saying, "So dear friends, since it has been the practice of God Almighty from time immemorial that He shows two manifestations so that the two false joys of the opponents be put to an end, it is now not possible that God Almighty should relinquish His practice of old. So do not grieve over what I have said to you, nor should your hearts be distressed." The Promised Messiah alayhi salam is granting comfort to his companions while informing them about his departure. "For it is essential for you to witness the second manifestation also, and its coming is better for you because it is everlasting, the continuity of which will not end until the Day of Judgment. And that second manifestation cannot come unless I depart. But when I depart, God will send that second manifestation for you, which shall always stay with you, just as promised by God in Braina Ahmadiyya. And this promise is not for my person. Rather, The promise is with reference to you, as God, addressing me, says, I shall make this Jamaat, who are your followers, prevail over others till the day of judgment. Thus, it is inevitable that you see the day of my departure, so that after that day, the day comes which is the day of everlasting promise. Our God is He who keeps His promise, and is faithful, and is the truthful God. He shall show you all that He has promised. Though these days are the last days of this world, and there are many a disaster waiting to happen, yet it is necessary that this world continues to exist until all those things about which God has prophesied comes to pass. I came from God as a manifestation of divine providence, and I am a personification of His power. And after I am gone, there will be some others who will be the manifestation of the second power of God. So while waiting for the second manifestation of His power, you all together keep yourselves busy praying. And let a Jamaat of righteous people, one and all, in every country keep themselves busy in prayers, so that the second manifestation may descend from the heaven and show that your God is a mighty God. Consider your death to be close at hand, for you never know when that hour will strike. Thus, difficulties will arise, as well as trials. However, the ultimate victory will belong to the Jamaat Ahmadiyya, God willing. The institution of Khilafat, which has been established through the advent of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, is now the only true institution through which success and also the peace and harmony of the world can be achieved. Conveying the glad tidings of this victory, the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, states, This is the way of God. And ever since He created man on earth, He has always been demonstrating this divine practice. That He helps His prophets and messengers and grants them success and predominance, as He says, كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَأَغْلِبَنَّ أَنَا وَرُسُلِي That God has ordained that He and His prophets shall prevail. This means that just as it is intended through the prophets and messengers that God Almighty should be recognized to an unparalleled extent, in the same manner God Almighty manifests their truth by showing profound signs. And just as they wish to establish the truth in the earth, God Almighty plants a seed through their hands. However, it does not flourish with them. Rather, on the contrary, He causes them to die and keeps a sense of fear with Himself. He enables the enemies to smear, slander and mock. Then, when they have finished with their disdain, He manifests His might and creates the means to complete the seemingly incomplete goal, and that then flourishes. Thus, He manifests two kinds of power. First, He shows the hand of His power at the hands of His prophets themselves. Second, when with the death of a prophet, difficulties and problems arise, and the enemies feel stronger and think that they are now in disarray and are convinced that now the Jamaat will become extinct, and even members of the Jamaat too are in quandary and their backs are broken, and some of the unfortunate ones choose the path that lead to apostasy. Then it is that God for the second time shows His mighty power and supports and takes care of the shaken Jamaat. Thus, one who remains steadfast till the end witnesses the miracle of God. This is what happened at the time of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, when the demise of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was considered untimely, and many an ignorant Bedouin turned apostate. The companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam too, stricken with grief, became like those who lose their senses. Then Allah raised Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu and showed for the second time the manifestation of His power and saved Islam, just when it was about to fall and fulfill the promise which was spelled out in the verse, وَلَيُمَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمُ الَّذِي ارْتَضَى لَهُمْ وَلَيُبَدِّلَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا That is, after the fear, we shall firmly re-establish them. It is a great favor of Allah the Almighty that although the Jamaat experienced a great shock at the time of the demise of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, however, Allah the Almighty immediately took care of the Jama'at through Hazrat Khalifatul Masih the First radiallahu anhu. And so even if anyone had any intention to create mischief, it was quickly quelled. Thereafter, the Jama'at experienced another shock when Hazrat Khalifatul Masih the First passed away, and certain prominent and leading members of the Jama'at abstained from taking the bayt, i.e. the oath of allegiance, and rejected the Khalifa, and the Jama'at endured a very difficult period during this time. Although this incident is quite detailed, but the ultimate result was that Khilafat succeeded and continued to progress and attain newer heights. Then, as I have mentioned previously, the Jama'at faced very hostile periods during the era of the third Khalifa, and despite the government's very horrific plans, Allah the Almighty bestowed His grace, and they could not impede the progress of the Jama'at. During the time of the fourth Khalifa, the Pakistani government intensified its persecution, and again Allah the Almighty granted the means to provide comfort. Moreover, the Jama'at continued to scale new heights, and newer means emerged for tabligh, i.e. propagation of the message of Islam. And then through the satellite system, we were able to do tabligh. Then during the era of the fifth Khalifa, the modes of the tabligh further expanded, and not just thousands or hundreds of thousands, but the message of the Jama'at has begun to reach millions. The opposition is no longer experienced in just one or two countries, but in many countries, and this in fact is the testimony of the Jama'at's truthfulness and a sign of its progress. There are efforts being made to deter people away from Ahmadiyyat. However, according to His divine promise, Allah the Almighty continues to unveil new avenues for the success of the Jama'at, and we are continuing to progress. All of this shows that despite the temporary hurdles, the victory of Islam is destined to happen through the promise of Messiah alayhi salam and the institution of Khilafat, which was established after him. The opponents can try and exert as much effort as they like. However, they are destined to face loss and failure. May Allah the Almighty enable each and every one of us to strengthen his and her faith and act righteously. May the standards of every Ahmadi's worship continue to increase so that we continue to partake of this success. After the Friday prayer, I shall lead a funeral prayer. Has the funeral prayer arrived? The funeral is of Chaudhry Hamid Ahmed Sahib, son of Chaudhry Muhammad Suleiman Akhtar Sahib. He had been living here in the UK for the last 7 to 8 years. He passed away on 20th of May 2017 at the age of 42. Surely to Allah we belong and to Him shall we return. He was the great-grandson of Hazrat Chaudhry Maula Baksh Sahib, a companion of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He migrated to Germany along with the rest of his family in 1990 and also served the Jama'at there in an outstanding manner. There he served as the local tabligh secretary, guide of his majlis, and also as the Mu'tamid of Germany. Apart from this, he also had the opportunity to serve as a secretary of Umur-e-Amma, i.e. general affairs, at a regional level. Apart from Khuddam al-Ahmadiyya Germany, he also served at the regional level for his Jama'at. He was also part of the delegation which represented Germany at the Jalsa in Bosnia. He had great interest in playing sports and also organized the tabligh stalls with great passion and diligence. If ever there was no one available to assist him, he would go on his own for the tabligh stall. In 2009, he left Germany and settled in the UK. Here, he had the opportunity to serve as the regional Nazim Talim for Atfal and help the Atfal of his majlis to attain a very high position. As I mentioned earlier, that he had a great passion for tabligh, and he had the opportunity to serve in various capacities, both in Khuddam al-Ahmadiyya and Ansarullah. He served in the private secretary office as a permanent volunteer and greatly helped in the processing of letters. He also gave security duties as a khadim, and at times I used to think that he did not do any other work and just stayed near the mosque the whole day. But he also used to do his private work and used to take time out of this. He would devote hours to help the private secretary's office and similarly for Khuddam duties. The deceased was a Musi and is survived by his wife, one daughter and four sons. His father is also alive, and his brothers. His father writes, "My son was extremely obedient. He remained occupied in the service of the Jamaat right from an early age, and his heart was filled with the passion to serve his religion. He always took great advantage of every opportunity he found to render his services. He would take his children to the mosque to offer congregational prayers, and even during the period of his illness, whenever his health improved slightly, he would continue with this practice. In the last stages, he battled with his illness with great courage. Even while at home, he continued with his work as Secretary of Waqf-e Noor." Similarly, his wife writes, "He had a very friendly relationship with the children and would always take care of their upbringing." She also stated that in the 15 years of our marriage, never did he speak with a raised voice. The UK's Mu'tamin Muqami writes, "He was extremely passionate towards serving Khilafat Ahmadiyya and the Nizam-e Jamaat, i.e. the administrative structure. He would always keep the best interests of the Jamaat at the forefront. He was admitted to hospital on a few occasions due to his illness, but would immediately return back to his duties as soon as his health improved even slightly. At times, one would not even notice that he was suffering from an illness. In the last stages of his illness, his only regret was that he could not offer his prayers at the mosque." One of his friends writes, "He used to taxi with me. On one occasion, he was first in the stand and I was after him. And when it was the time for prayer, he left, whereas I remained thinking that perhaps a passenger will come. However, he offered his prayers and returned, and still received the first passenger, and I failed to get any. Thus, this taught me a lesson that one should sacrifice their worldly affairs. Worshipping and fulfilling the obligations we owe to Allah the Almighty should always come first. Therefore, in this way, he would silently reform his colleagues." One of his great qualities was that he was willing to help everyone. One of his friends writes, "Even if there was work needed to be done at 2 a.m, he would immediately say that it would be done." Regarding tabligh stores, Atal Mujib Rashid Sahib writes, "He would regularly go for the tabligh stores and would always have a smile and would offer the greetings of peace to everyone while working." In fact, he writes, "I once inquired about his health from a friend of his and he said that he was feeling a little better, so he left for tabligh. May Allah the Almighty elevate his status and grant him mercy and forgiveness. And may he also enable his children to become pious and virtuous and enable them to remain attached with Khilafat. As I mentioned, the funeral is present here and therefore after the prayers, I will go down to lead the funeral prayer and you all are to form the lines for the prayers in the mosque."
Alhamdulillah. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد ان لا اله الا الله ونشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر